thank you very much, Masumi, for that very kind introduction to me and my work. When I was a student of philosophy, all my teachers were passionate atheists. When I was at Cambridge University as an undergraduate, people mocked the idea of studying religious belief. My supervisor said to me at the end of my undergraduate degree, "Why are you wasting your time wanting to do a PhD on the question of the existence of God or evidence for God? Religious people, you know, they can't seem to sort their differences out. They're constantly fighting. Look at the deadlocks, the permanent stalemates between Jews and Christians and Muslims." And it struck me that there was some truth in that. And that actually has been something which has interested me throughout my academic life. Why is it that there's this degree of denominational diversity? That's a polite way of saying sectarianism and the bitterness it causes, including bloodshed. Don't forget the rivalry between different sects of Islam, or indeed Islam and the Abrahamic religions. That rivalry is not restricted to the footnotes of academic journals. It's a real rivalry. People actually do kill and fight over it every day. That's why it's of great interest to me. So although it's a theological puzzle, what I mean by a theological puzzle is that it's a puzzle that involves the, by definition, undiscoverable motives of God. So obviously, only a philosopher would have the audacity to even probe such a topic. Certainly, I'm not actually interested in the sociology of religion. I mean, obviously, I don't want to make factual mistakes. So when I talk or when you engage me at the end, you can ask me about different sects and including factual details about them. But as a philosopher, I believe that the unique contribution of philosophy of religion is to ask the deeper questions, in my view, as to why there is this degree of denominational diversity in a major religion. Now, this to me is particularly puzzling in the case of Islam. I will be making comparisons with the Christianity because, of course, Christianity is the other major religious superpower in the world, so Muslims need to be aware of it, just as Christians need to be aware of Islam's presence. But there's a verse in the Quran, in Surah Al-Baqarah, that and this is repeated in several places in the Quran, so it's a motif of the Quran, not an incidental emphasis, that had we willed, we could have made mankind into a single community. So the question is, why didn't God will it? Obviously, it would have saved a great deal of bloodshed in the world, but of course he didn't. And that's where the question is difficult, because it may be at the limits of the ghaib or the unknown. It may be a blasphemous question to raise. There's no question, however, that factually there are deadlocks between the major Islamic denominations. Now, in the two books that Masumi mentioned, the Quran and the Secular Mind is in part a nuanced exploration of the rise of Ash'arite Sunni orthodoxy and also of Abu Hanifa and the schools of Islamic, the four schools of Sunni law, how they emerged along with the nascent theological tradition of the Mu'tazila or the rationalists, the development of philosophy in Islam, which was essentially seen, and I think rightly in my view, as a foreign Greek product. That's a more nuanced discussion, but what I'm interested in doing in here and to engage you today, rather than to read from some extract from those two rather lengthy works, which trace it in some academic detail, the evolution of this view. What I'm interested in knowing is, and I'd like to plant this thought in your mind, is why do you think, for what reason, theologically or morally, would God permit this degree of difference? I mean, for example, in the case of the earliest and most important Islamic division, that between the Shi'at Ali and the Sunni world, that is not analogous to the Catholic Protestant Reformation, or that big split, which whose 500th anniversary is coming up next year, 1517 to 500 years ago, those theses were nailed on the church in Wittenberg in Germany. It's not analogous because the Shia-Sunni difference actually is fundamental to Islam. In my view, it's a great tragedy that it happened, because I think it permanently has ruptured the unity of the Islamic world. another theological puzzle as to why that has happened. It's interesting that in the New Testament, in the Gospel of John, Jesus as high priest prays for the unity of his people, and that prayer is not granted, it seems, judging by the degree of denominational diversity in the Christian faith. And I noticed ever since I was a young boy attending Friday prayers that there were countless prayers addressed to God from the minarets of countless mosques, asking for praying for unity of the Muslim world. And obviously those prayers have not been answered, because in fact, on the contrary, the diversity and bitterness seems to be increasing. So that's the deeper question, it seems to me. And in the case of the Shia-Sunni distinction, unfortunately, this distinction, this bitterness has increased in the last, say, 25 years with the emergence of, you know, Shiite Islam as a major political power in the world. Now, I am actually myself a Sunni Muslim, and it is my considered opinion, although it will obviously appear to you as being sectarian, that Sunni Islam is the most ecumenical version of Islam, because it does to some extent take account of certain aspects of Shiite history, meaning it accepts that there's a legitimate grievance in some of the shameful actions of some nominal Sunnis and what they did to the Prophet's line in 680 on that shameful 10th of Muharram. But this obviously, as a concession, is not enough to satisfy Shiite sensibilities, so therefore the rift continues. Some very distinguished Shiites, such as the late Imam Ayatollah Khomeini, did have a Wahdat movement, a unity week, you know, where he wanted to promote the idea that we can't talk through our differences. But obviously the theological differences that have developed are quite profound. They are post-Quranic, which makes it more difficult to adjudicate. What I mean by that is that, so for example, the notion of the imamate, insofar as it is something that is extra-Quranic, obviously it's very difficult to have any kind of normative way of deciding the issue. If it were a Quranic matter, meaning something that to which Quranic criteria could be applied, then there'd be an agreed authority to which we could all appeal. Unfortunately, we can't do that, because most of the authorities in this type of post-Quranic schism or division would be controversial to one party or the other. The only thing we would have in common would be some attempt at reasoning, human reasoning, and maybe some attempt to look at the application of historical method to see what actually happened. It might help you in looking at denominational differences. I mentioned the Shia-Sunni one, to ask yourself, to compare it with the Christian world, where there's been for long an agreed distinction between, if you like, three ways in which people can differ from orthodoxy. And it will help the looking and the classification of Islamic differences. There are several different criteria, but one of them is that if somebody commits apostasy, that's different from committing an act of heresy, and both of them are different from being schismatic. Let me just explain that distinction, and then we can apply it to a more empirical model of, you know, which actual groups fit into it. So obviously apostasy in the case of Islam would mean someone who took exception to the dual testimony of faith. I testify that there's no God except Allah and that Muhammad is the messenger of Allah. If you took exception to either of the two clauses, then you would cease to be a Muslim, meaning you would be an apostate. In the military context, if you then joined an opposing army, obviously then you belong to a group that is at war with Islam and you could be engaged in military combat. This particular dual confession of faith, that there's no God except one God and Muhammad is the messenger of God, it can be supplemented. I mean, for example, in the Shiite confession, you may want to add about the fact that Imam Ali is the Wali of Allah. That's fine. It's an additional comment as opposed to one that contradicts the existing two. On the other hand, if you were to take exception to one of these two clauses, as has generally been thought to be the case with the Ahmadiyya movement, which has been formally declared as being apostates, not merely heretical, which would be taking exception to one aspect of this, but simply losing the faith completely, then obviously that would be a matter for judgment by the collective consensus of the Islamic community. And that decision has been made in that it is seen that they deny the finality of the Prophet Muhammad. Now, of course, they will argue that the Shahada does not mention the finality of the Prophet. It just says Muhammad is the messenger of God. It doesn't say, by the way, he's the only messenger of God. since there are other messengers of God like Jesus and so on, right? So they would say that this cannot be true. But then you can cite additional Quranic evidence. For example, Surah Ahzab says the Khatm al-Nabiyyin, the seal of the prophets, which is generally understood by Sunni orthodoxy and by Shias to mean that this is a termination in the succession of prophets. So that's one way of looking at the question of apostasy, that you'd have to take exception to one of the core clauses. In my own view, the creed of Islam actually could simply consist of the second clause. I think the first one is unnecessary. It's redundant, although it's implied in the second one. Because if you say that Muhammad is the messenger of Allah, that presupposes that there is a one deity called Allah. So in a sense, it already covers it. So it's partly redundant, but nonetheless, it is acceptable because it broadens the range of who can be called a monotheist, meaning the question of denominations within the Abrahamic family, because Christians and Jews will also claim to be monotheists, although according to Islam, of course, their monotheism is errant, meaning it is not perfect, it's compromised in some way, particularly the charges made against Christians that their monotheism is not pristine or pure. The charge is less often made against Jews, but it is in fact made in the Quran on a couple of occasions. For example, the verse saying that they associate Ezra with God, which is a very strange accusation because it's very hard to find any independent rabbinic or Talmudic evidence for it. The second category, which will help us in looking at denominations within Islam, certainly, and elsewhere too. And as I say, please feel free to ask me about any particular group and where we stand on it. The second group would be where the doctrine is heretical. Now, that would be where there's a degree of a management of legitimate dissent, meaning, for example, in my own view, since I accept four schools of law, I belong to the Hanafi school of law. And I know there's a fifth school of law, the Jafriya or the Shiite school of law, which is official in Iran. I'm quite happy to accept the people who follow that particular school of law as being Muslim. Obviously, in my view, they're heretical, and in their opinion, I'm a heretic. But heresy is a different kind of accusation from apostasy. And both of them, by the way, are different from saying that somebody is merely sinful. Because the idea that somebody is sinful, at least when said of ordinary believers, as opposed to seminal believers such as the Prophet or the Imams in the case of the Shias, all of us would accept as believers that we are sinful, meaning we're not perfect, that we lead sinful lives for which we need to have constant repentance. This is a view that is also in a modified form held by Christians as well about their own faith. So that question about heresy is to do with a doctrinal error, not to do with the question of conduct. Because remember that in the question of whether you're a believer or not, a Muslim that is, the legal definition of a Muslim, one who submits to Islam, as opposed to the more complex question of mu'min, one who has iman or faith, the simple question is you simply say in the presence of two male witnesses and one male or two female witnesses that you there's no God except God and Muhammad is his messenger. Having said that, you are actually a Muslim and are subject to the Sharia. So there are consequences merely in the uttering of one sentence. But the advantage is, the privilege is that no one has a right after that to say to you that you are not a believer, even if your conduct is sinful. Because that's for God to decide. That matter is then deferred for God's judgment. Not always been the case, by the way, as you know. In early Islamic history, this was one of the biggest issues that rose for the Muslims as to whether the person who commits a grave sin ceases to be a Muslim and becomes an infidel. The Khawarij group, which is the earliest terrorist group, the ISIS people are probably the latest version of that. They would say that if you commit a grave sin, which would be, say, something like adultery, at the moment of committing adultery, you cease to be a believer. In fact, they would even have said that you're an infidel. Whereas other Muslims would have said, well, you are a sinful Muslim, but you're still a Muslim. In fact, you may even have iman, meaning you have faith, particularly if you confess what you did was wrong and are willing to take a punishment in this world, because you know that whatever happens, you will certainly be subject to punishment in the next world, because the eschatological sanction has been deferred. And in the next world, nobody gets away with having a clever lawyer to get you off the hook. You will definitely be subject to the divine punishment. So it would be a kind of testimony to the quality of your iman or faith that you are willing to admit that you've done something wrong, even if nobody could catch you out. Because there are many things we indulge in, which are, of course, not discoverable by other people, but we are aware that they're sinful, which is why we need to have a constant repentance. So the question of heresy is not about grace and works, to use a Christian distinction. The Christian idea is that the reason I chose to write my commentary on Galatians is because the idea that it is grace alone that counts for justification of the sinner, and that the works of the law, which means the Torah, are not important for salvific purposes, it is the cause of the rupture between Judaism and Christianity. And it's important for Muslims to be aware of this, because Islam is a kind of return to the Jewish idea that the law is important. As you know, in the Quran, the expression, those who believe, meaning those who have faith, Alladhina amanu, wa amilu salihat, and who perform righteous actions, is like an organic amalgam. It's assumed that both are required, and that the fruits of iman will be good righteous action. And incidentally, it's a slander to say that Christians don't believe that. In practice, the idea in Christianity, is in Paul's preaching certainly, is that you should do good works, but they are not the ones that qualify you in some sense. You don't earn salvation. And the interesting thing is actually that the earliest Islamic debates were about this question, which led to denominational diversity. I mean, the debate between the Murji'ites, the people who wanted to postpone these decisions, and the Khawarij, the people who wanted to exclude certain people, and the Mu'tazila in general, as a rationalist school, who wanted to preserve the notion of God being a just being who would not send people to hell arbitrarily or to heaven arbitrarily. That idea really was the same debate as in Christianity. In other words, which is important, iman, meaning grace, or faith, or works of the law? And it's a misunderstanding of all of these religions to think that any of them believe that your own works or your own good actions qualify you or earn you merit with God to the point of getting into heaven. Nobody has a guarantee of entering heaven on the basis of their works. It is always by God's grace. But the point is that we are still expected, in view of the revelation of the Quran, to do certain kinds of good actions. So that would be the question of heresy. In other words, which doctrinal error are you making? Not necessarily which error in conduct you're making. A doctrinal error, for example, would be a person who thought, out of pride, that my actions are good enough to qualify me to enter heaven. That person would definitely be disqualified. The grounds in the Christian, to use Christian vocabulary, is hubris, meaning extreme pride, or takabbur in the case of Islam. And it is no question about it that God is like to forgive even the greatest sinner if he has the humility, or she has the humility, to admit they're wrong. Whereas in the most righteous man in the world, if he contaminates his piety by being hubristic about it, or having a hubristic kind of confidence that I will definitely be able to enter paradise in view of what I've done, would obviously be committing a major sin. So this is a cardinal sin, in fact. So this is not the dispute between us. The real question is, to what extent the heretic commits an error of doctrine, meaning he believes something about the nature of God, which, although permissible, meaning not sufficient to remove him from the ambit of Islam, is nonetheless a serious error. And of course, as you know, Sunnis believe that the Shiite view of history and about the caliphate amounts to heresy, because it is an untrue account of what took place. Maybe the audience can engage me after the lecture, if there's particular questions of history that you would like to tackle with me. My own view is that the Sunni view of history is quite eclectic and broad enough to encompass Shiite grievances. Sadly, it is felt that it is not enough. The third grouping would be schismatics, meaning people who are heretics who then go on to found a whole group of people who are also heretics, and in that way undermine not only the unity of the faith, but pose an active military threat. And these three groups, incidentally, are found, this terminology I borrowed from the Catholic Catechism. The Catholics still use this vocabulary in identifying certain people when they're looking at, of course, in the past they would also burn people at the stake for heresy, and apostasy also was punishable, for example, in the time of Justinian, by death. So this is not unique to Islam. But it would help if we're looking at denominational differences. What's unusual about Islam's denominational differences, in my opinion, is that they arise despite the fact that the Quran is a very short work and very explicit in defining what Islam is and what faith is. This cannot be said, in my view, of other scriptures. For example, I think that the New Testament does not give a clear description of what a Christian is. And of course, Jesus was not a Christian, whereas Muhammad was certainly a Muslim. And also the fact that the New Testament canonizes certain differences. For example, the views of James and the views of Paul on the faith and meaning the grace versus law debate are, in my view, significantly different. Now, of course, I don't mean to imply that if we caricature the views of James and caricature the views of Paul, I mean even after a nuanced and sophisticated study with responsible New Testament scholarship, in my view, the views of these two apostles on faith and works do differ, and I'd be very happy to, in fact, I'd love to debate Christians in public on this point. In Oxford, no one seems to have done it with me so far, because, you know, the Oxford academics, their method of dealing with somebody who disagrees with them is to ignore them, especially if it's a clever foreigner belonging to another religion that they don't like. But I hope that people here will actually take me up on the offer if they're Christians and be happy to be very happy to debate that question. So the puzzles for me are very deep about why is it that these denominational differences not only exist but have a political dimension and have led to so much bloodshed in Islam and continue to do so. And these stalemates seem to be persisting. To go back to my point, as a philosopher who was distressed by this, when I subsequently started working seriously upon both Shiite Islam and upon Christianity, which I regard as kindred faiths in many ways, and I'll explain why, I was struck even deeper by why is it that God, in revealing his will for mankind, his legal and moral will for mankind in the Quran, did not see fit to give any verdict that would lead to a decisive resolution of these disputes. The fact that intelligent and sincere people can be on different sides of these sectarian disputes within religions and among the related Abrahamic religions, I think that's a very disturbing fact of contemporary practice and indeed of historical practice too. So how does one resolve that, if indeed one can? For practical purposes, when I'm studying, for example, denominational differences between my own Sunni faith and Shiites, what I do is I try and suspend judgment. And I did the same in the case of my work on the New Testament. Suspend judgment. Now, what that means in practice is that although I must go eventually to the Quran for a final decisive judgment on Christianity, when the judgment is that Christianity is only partly true, it's not a scandal, by the way. It is still a true religion in its origins. Unlike in the opposite direction, I think Christians are obliged to see Islam as merely a scandal and not merely a falsehood, a less generous view, I think. But nonetheless, there's no way of deciding this puzzle or this stalemate on this side of the grave. We may have what John Hick called post-mortem eschatological verification, which means after we die, we find out. But of course, it's too late. I mean, for example, in my case, if I die and I find out that I was wrong as a Sunni, I think my first reaction would be total incredulity, because I'm so convinced of the truth of what I believe that I would say, my God, this is quite extraordinary. Why did God allow me to persist in a mistake? Especially as a philosopher of religion, I feel a kind of special claim that God should have said to me in some indirect oblique way that this is a major mistake you're making. One of the advantages of being an empirical student of religion or a sociologist, as I'm sure some of you are, is of course that you don't have to ask these more difficult questions, which by definition have really no answers. Unfortunately, this is the nature of any philosophical inquiry about differences between people. But what strikes me is that if conscientious people, including conscientious atheists, can be so convinced of the truth of something, and to all appearances seem conscientious as well as intelligent, and then you have conscientious and intelligent Muslims, and they can't seem to agree upon what the correct answer is, then I thought the only method I could use was to suspend my own judgment in studying other people with whom I disagree. Now, this method is something that is very difficult to do. I should add, by the way, that when I was teaching in America, I asked my Christian students, where I taught New Testament, if they were willing for 3 hours to suspend the view that the New Testament was the inspired word of God, and all of them said no. 3 hours is too long. We cannot possibly do that. So I'd actually like to ask you, keep this question in mind for the answering question, how long would you be willing to suspend your commitment to the truth of your most cherished religious convictions for academic and intellectual purposes? Would it be for a day? Could you spend a whole day pretending to be a Buddhist, for example, as opposed to whatever your own faith is, whether you're a Shiite, Muslim, or a Christian? Because I think the only way we can find out why there is denominational diversity in the world, a diversity that God himself tolerates, rather mysteriously, incidentally, you know, the Quran doesn't offer a reason as to why it has permitted the human community to remain doctrinally divided. The only possible answer would be that God wants you to vie with each other in good works. This does come in the Quran, right? That you all have different opinions. God alone will decide your differences on the day of resurrection. That seems to imply that nothing can be done here to resolve these differences. And in the meantime, we'll simply have this enormous, rich diversity, empirically considered, of sectarian divisions in the human family. And what makes it so bitter is that, at least in the case of the Shiite-Sunni division, and also I think to some extent in the case of the Abrahamic family division, is that these are family quarrels. And when you have something in common with the person you fight, it's much more bitter. I mean, if any of you have the kind of relationship I have with my siblings, it's nothing to be envied. I mean, we're always constantly disagreeing on things. And I think that the rivalry between the Abrahamic cousins, if you like, is evidence of a dysfunctional family. It's a dysfunctional family, obviously, because for over 3,000 years they've been fighting with each other. They've not managed to resolve their differences. And in fact, the differences seem to be getting deeper every year, as any of you know who have visited Jerusalem. So in terms of the question I want to ask you is, why do you think these differences persist? And if you would like to disagree with me, I invite you to disagree with me. It'll give me a chance to refute you. I invite you to disagree with me about any particular factual or empirical claim about, you know, a particular group in Islam. We are very happy to take questions about that. I mean, I could talk a bit further, but I actually would prefer, Masuma, with your permission, to lay it open, and then I can engage in some depth with the questions, meaning it'll give me a chance to expatiate on particular points. But I think this is enough for you to know what the anxieties I have experienced, and, you know, please.
Thank you very much, Dr. Akhtar, for thought-provoking lectures and very deep philosophical questions. But I think for some of our audiences, mm-hmm. they want to know about, you know, the Shia-Sunni division, where, you know, it was started.
Okay.
And you talked about, you know, schools of laws and thought.
Yeah.
Maybe just if you...
A bit more factual detail.
And then, you know, I'm sure there will be lots of questions.
Sure, I'll do that. Okay, all right. Well, of course, as you know, in the case of the Shia-Sunni division, it goes back to people and figures who are involved in the life of the Prophet Muhammad himself, right? So we're talking about his cousin Ali, and one of the early converts to Islam, possibly the earliest male convert to Islam. The question is whether it was a usurpation of his right when the other three caliphs, Abu Bakr, Umar, and Uthman, took precedence over him. Or should it have been the case that the charisma of the family of Muhammad, biologically considered, should have remained within that family, meaning Ali should have been the first successor, and there should have been an imamate, meaning a series of imams, whether 12, which is the more orthodox version, or 7. And then within the Shiite division, within the marginalia of Shiite orthodoxy, there'll also be heretical groups, meaning splinter groups within that complex history. But, you know, this would be the big division between what is called Sunni Islam. The important thing to remember here, for those of you who are unfamiliar with this very bitter struggle about political succession, is that it was essentially an issue about political succession in the beginning, and that the theological underpinnings grew up later, and in my view, were extra-Quranic. Never forget that the Shiite movement, the Shi'at Ali, the partisans of Ali, was an Arab sectarian movement. I think a lot of people think of it as something to do with Iran, which of course is a very recent thing. I mean, I think you could date it to the Safavid dynasty. Would that be a fair point, Masumi? Last 400 years?
It's more historical, you know, when you look Right. Division goes to very, very...
Yeah, but I'm saying Iran. Yeah. A lot of people in the popular imagination... Yeah, of course, the division goes back to the very founding figures of Islam, which is why I said that it's not to be compared with the Reformation, with the Catholic-Protestant division, which is actually a very late one. I mean, it occurs almost 1,600 years into the Christian history, therefore... doesn't have a parallel to that. Now the question is about the events surrounding the way in which the Umayyad dynasty, the first dynasty, dealt with the Shiite option, if you like. I think that Sunni orthodoxy recognizes that the people who were martyred in 680 were righteous and were true defenders of Islam. There's no question about that, and that Muawiyah and his son Yazid were not, in that sense, good Muslims. That question has been accepted, but since the Sunni orthodoxy wants to be eclectic and comprehensive, they are saying, let's defer this judgment to God, and for us, we can happily say that there are four caliphs, beginning with Abu Bakr, Umar, Usman, and Ali, and give each of them their due. And then there are more sectarian Sunni writers who would make more polemical accusations. They'd say, well, Ali was a very righteous man, but perhaps he wasn't suited to leadership, because, as you know, people who are righteous and God-fearing are not always good politicians. And perhaps, you know, there's an implied compliment in that. So there's all sorts of things that people can... You know, in terms of the complexity of history, another point that is sometimes made by Sunni apologists and polemicists is that the rate of expansion of the Islamic Empire actually dramatically declined under Ali, and that its zenith, its high point, was under Omar. Usman, who was responsible for the codification of the Qur'an, not canonization, by the way, codification. The Qur'an has not been canonized because it's self-described as canonical. Another false parallel with Christianity, which of course has an apocrypha and a canon. And under Usman, there was the development of the navy, and the conquest continued. So under Ali, it seems that there was so much sectarian strife between him and various prophetic companions of the Prophet, it became an internal, you know, struggle between them. A lot of their energy was sapped. So instead of the external expansion of the Islamic empire, instead, you know, these Arab tribes and people, including Ali himself and the Prophet's widow Aisha and others, became involved in sectarian fitna or internal struggle. And so a lot of people, Sunni apologists, have often said that it's a shame that the period of the four rightly guided caliphs should have consisted in which three of them were assassinated. I mean, what message does that give to non-Muslims? They say, well, so the Islamic golden age basically consisted of people assassinating each other. And shamefully, it has continued this way because, as you know, a lot of Muslim leaders, unfortunately, are very reluctant to leave office without the additional inducement of assassination. Sometimes you have to kill them before you can get rid of them. I'm sure you know the kind of people I'm talking about in the current climate as well. So there have been some accusations of that type within the, you know, I'm sure it's an endless debate between the Shia and the Sunni. But I think for outsiders, it's a bit of a puzzle as to why there's this degree of religious passion around the figure of Hussein, particularly. In the events of 680 and Karbala. I think a lot of people who are not Muslim, I mean, if you're a Sunni Muslim, you have some idea as to why, because of the fact that you also have equal love for the Ahlul Bayt, the prophetic family. But if you're not a Muslim in any sense, I mean, for example, those who have watched, say, Ashura processions in Iran have probably wondered, for whom are these people mourning? And I think they find it difficult to believe that they're mourning for somebody who died almost 1,400 years ago. They think it's probably some relative who died recently. But of course, you know, such is the long reach of history. And in terms of the development of the imams, beginning with Imam Ali, and then, you know, there will be 12 in the Orthodox, you know, the 12 Shias, along with the final imam who is in occultation or hiding and who is expected to return. This is an interesting an important feature of the Shiite faith, incidentally, which I think distinguishes it from Orthodoxy, in the sense that I think that Shiism is a messianic religion, one focused on suffering and redemption, and these are Christian themes too. And that's why I said earlier on that I actually think of Shia as essentially as Christians. It's meant as a compliment, by the way. Because I think the idea of waiting for someone to deliver us and to rescue us from the perils of history is not a Sunni view. view. Why do I say that? Well, I say that, you know, as a PS to this question about Shia Sunni, is that I think there's a very remarkable feature of the Prophet Muhammad's ministry, that he built his heavenly city on this side of the grave, as opposed to people like Paul. Paul thought the world was about to end and there was no need to build anything on this earth. There was an interim ethics provided in Corinthians because, you know, the world was about to end. And yet, in the Quran as well, there's a lot of imminence about the Day of Judgment, and yet despite that imminence and fear that it could happen at any time, the Yawm al-Qiyamah, why did the Prophet build his political providence in Medina for 10 years, a proper functioning state, and indeed trained his caliphs and lieutenants to colonize the world? This cannot be the view of somebody who thinks that the world is about to end. And that's why I don't think that Sunni Islam is a messianic religion. I don't think it's waiting for somebody to come and rescue us, whereas I think Shiaism is. And that's the reason why I think it's, in my view, that's the real reason it's heretical, and not because of some minor, trivial, superficial, doctrinal reason. Is that sufficient, Masumi, for now? If people want to, you know, ask me further questions, I'm very happy to engage.